So we have Yukti Bhardwaj, one of the students who will be moderating for the session today. So I'll ask her to take over then.
Yes, sure.
A very good morning to all. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, we are audible.
Okay, thank you, sir. A very good morning to one and all present here. Today, I, Yukti Bhardwaj, on behalf of the Center for Legal Studies, Geetada International Business School, welcome our esteemed guest, Advocate Mr. Jeet Bhatt, and all the attendees on today's personality development workshop on the topic Legal Career Counsel and Professional Need. Geetada International Business School was established in the year 2004. GIBS is affiliated to Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, Delhi, and is approved by All India Council for Technical Education, Ministry of HRD, Government of India for Technical Programs, and Bar Council of India for Law Programs. GIBS is currently offering postgraduate programs, that is MBA, MBA International Business, MCA Integrated and Undergraduate Programs, that is BBLLB, BLLB, and BBA. GIBS has been graded A by National Assessment and Accreditation Council in second cycle. It is an ISO 9001, 2008 certified institute. GIBS has been rated A plus by State Fee Regulatory Committee, a fee committee of Government of NCT of Delhi, and rated highest grading A by Joint Inspection Committee of Government of NCT of Delhi, GGISP University. GIBS has been rated grade A by Academic Audit Cell of GGISP University consecutively for past 5 years. Also, GIBS has been rated number 2 by Times B School Survey 2021. At GIBS, thrust is on overall personality development of students so that they can face the challenges in their competitive professional life with value-based approach. Apart from providing quality education, emphasis is on to develop leadership qualities, risk-taking abilities, and decision-making skills right from the beginning of their professional education. Going by this agenda, the Institute conducts personality development workshops on regular basis. Keeping the aforementioned objective, this session intends to unfold the role and functioning of Bar Council of India and State Bar Councils in legal fraternity. Bar Council of India, a statutory body created by the Parliament of India, regulates and represents Indian Bar. It prescribes standard of professionals' conduct and etiquettes and further exercises disciplinary jurisdiction over the bar. It sets standards for legal education in consultants with prominent universities in India imparting the same. Moreover, it grants recognition to the universities after regular visits and inspection, whose degree in law will serve as qualification for enrollment as an advocate. Further, it performs certain representative functions by protecting the rights, privileges, and interests of advocates and through the creation of funds for providing financial assistance to organize welfare schemes for them. Furthermore, the Bar Council plays a crucial role in creating awareness and organized legal aid for the underprivileged class. It is pertinent for an undergraduate in law to be aware of the intricacies and the functioning of Indian Bar. Considerable attention should be provided in the legal education to impart awareness about the functioning of Bar Council of India and State Bar Councils. The guest speaker of webinar today is well-known Mr. Jeet Bhatt, Advocate High Court. Am I audible?
Yes, now you're audible.
Yes, now you're audible, Yukti. You can continue with sir's introduction.
Yeah. Sir has graduated from the first batch of GNLU, Gandhinagar, in 2009. After working for almost a year, he went on to pursue an LLM in corporate and commercial law from Queen Mary University of London. After finishing his master's, he had the opportunity to work at Markin Cooperative in property matters. He later quit the company and came back to Gujarat and joined full-fledged litigation practice. He practices in Gujarat High Court since 2009 after graduating from Gujarat National Law University. Appearing on standing counsel for the official liquidator attached to the High Court of Gujarat since 2018. He also appears as an advocate for Western Railway and GUVNL. We are honored to have you, sir. I would now take the opportunity to invite sir to enlighten us with his immense pool of knowledge and experience.
Thank you. Thank you, Yukti, for the kind words.
Thank you, sir.
And introducing me and also introducing your college and your institution. It's an honor for me to be here along with all of you and to deliver a lecture on this very important topic on role of the Bar Council of India as well as the State Bar Council. Since this is a personality development class, I would try to make it as practical and try to give you some of my insights into the legal profession. As Yukti said, I have been practicing since 2009, and probably around now it has been 11 years since that I've been practicing. So I'm a little older than you, but not a very, very experienced or a senior member of the bar. But still, I consider myself to be a young member at the bar. Even after 12 years, I feel I'm still a young junior lawyer, still pursuing my career in this vast profession. So this legal profession, and that is how I wanted to start this class, and also congratulate you as you have already entered into your fourth year, and probably very soon you are going to enter into this profession. And it is a very mesmerizing profession. Of course, it is a very challenging profession. And also, as recently Supreme Court judge said, that is one of the most thrilling professions you can enter into. So yes, this is a, and we have a very rich history of legal profession and how it has developed over the years. Certainly it has been developed on the lines of the British legal profession, but still there are some differences between the British legal system and the Indian legal system. We don't have this solicitor barrister sort of a two different dual professions. Lawyers here can solicit and also can appear in court. There's a distinction in UK. The solicitors cannot appear and have a right of audience before the court. But here, any advocate who has been engaged, enrolled with the Bar Council of a state, has the right to appear and argue in any court in the country. So that is the difference, basic difference between the two systems. But otherwise everything which we are following is based on the British system, except what I had seen in UK when I was there in their courts. The lawyers and solicitors wear a wig, even the judges wear a wig, which fortunately we do not have to wear. So we have to wear the gown and the attire, but fortunately we don't have to wear a wig and sit in the court. So that's a good part of what we have not followed from the British system. So yes, we'll start basically with a brief history of how the legal profession developed in India and what were the earlier enactments, and just briefly take you to that. And then we'll go to the Advocates Act of 1961, which basically deals with the entire, which consolidates the laws with regards to the legal profession. And then we will briefly deal with the professional etiquettes and the professional conduct rules that have been framed by the Bar Council under the Advocates Act. And then, if there is time permits, then we'll discuss about the legal profession, and I can take your questions, whatever you have, about the practical aspects of litigation. Because that is what I've been doing since graduated from GNL. And therefore, you can ask me any question, any sort of a question or any worry that you have with regards to litigation, we can try to answer that. So I prepared a small PPT I'll share with you with regards to the history of legal profession. So we'll be speaking about the history of legal profession in India. And as I said, it has its origins to the British legal system. But there are some interesting facts which I have gathered here. How the British established themselves in India and how these chartered high courts, because earlier we had three chartered high courts, that is Bombay, Calcutta and Madras, and later on other high courts evolved, like Allahabad and Punjab and all other, then every state had its own high court after independence. But earlier, you must be aware that Bombay was part of the Portuguese colony, and later on Portugal were restricted only to Goa, Daman and Diu. And so therefore King of Portugal in 1661 presented the island of Bombay to the British crown because of the marriage of King Charles with the Catherine of Braganza. So it is because of this marriage that the Britishers got the island of Bombay. And it is by way of a charter of 27th March 1669 that King Charles II transferred the island to East India Company. And that is how the East India Company got into the possession of the island of Bombay. And since they came with regards to trade, but then later on took over the possessions and the properties and took the control. But in 1694, the East India Company later on became the Zamindar in Bengal due to the purchase of villages with the consent of Nawab of Bengal. So initially in Bombay, then they shifted to Bengal, and then later on they also established a settlement in Madras by 1694. So thereafter they wanted, because they were here for business and there were disputes, they wanted to administer company's courts. So they established courts for administration of justice and settlement of disputes. And that is how by a charter dated 24-9-1726, courts of record were established in Bombay, Madras and Calcutta. And that is a precursor to the establishment of the chartered high courts. It is by way of these charters, and that is why they are called as chartered high court, because they were constituted under a charter. So this is a brief history of how the British took over the possessions, got into the possession of Bombay, Madras, Calcutta, and how they started the first court of records by way of a charter in 1726. Though earlier there were courts, and the Mughal courts were also administrating justice, because at that time India was under the reins of the Mughals. And also there have been traces of even earlier times during the, as you must be aware, Manuspriti, which were the earlier laws governing the entire region. And there were lawyers. So the legal profession has been there, and it is one of the oldest professions known to mankind. So certainly it's a very, very old profession. And the current setup that we have is mostly taken from the British legal system. So thereafter, the Bengal regulation of 1793, which can be said to have created for the first time a regular legal profession in India. And it empowered the adalats, that are the courts, to enroll pleaders. So that is how from 1793, the proper legal setup came to be created, which empowered the adalats of the courts to enroll pleaders. And you will see a lot of different terms were used, like pleaders, muktars, wakils, attorneys, advocates, etc. But later on with the Advocates Act, now it is only advocates, either a senior advocate or an advocate. And they can practice in any courts across the country. Earlier, it was restricted to the courts where they were practicing. And originally, when the British set up these courts, only the Britishers and persons from Scotland were entitled to practice the profession. But later on, with the Legal Practitioners Act of 1846, which permitted people of any religion or nationality to be eligible to become pleaders. So since then, the legal profession has been thriving and developing in this country. This is a very important development for the Legal Practitioners Act of 1846, which was enacted by the British Parliament. So thereafter, another development came in the year 1858 with the enactment of the Government of India Act. And this was the first Government of India, because you must be aware in history, you must have read the 1856 mutiny, and how thereafter the British government took over the entire administration of the territory, which were earlier governed by the East India Company. So this Government of India Act of 1858 is an important development in history. And since then, after this Government of India Act, came the Indian High Courts Act of 1862, which was again passed by the British Parliament, authorizing the creation of high courts in several presidencies instead of the Supreme Courts. So, so earlier, since 1793, the act we saw, there were Supreme Courts which are set up in Bengal, Calcutta, and Madras. But with the Indian High Courts Act of 1862, they were replaced by the High Courts. So earlier, what was known as the Supreme Courts were now termed as the High Courts. So in 1862, the first High Court, that is the High Court of Calcutta, was set up in India. And in 1865, the High Court of Bombay and Madras were set up. Thereafter, the Britishers enacted the Criminal Procedure Code of 1898. Also, the Code of Civil Procedure was enacted. And they reorganized the criminal courts into courts of session, presidency magistrates, magistrates of the first, second, and third classes. So this is how, with the development of the courts and the setup of judicial officers, did the profession of law develop in this country. This is a brief precursor to how the legal profession started developing with the Britishers. And then came the latest Patent Act of 1865, which authorized the High Courts to approve, admit, and enroll advocates, wakils, and attorneys for the High Courts. So this is how earlier laws were not, there were not a single law which consolidated all these laws. And therefore, after independence, an All India Bar Committee was set up in the year 1953, which drafted the Advocates Act of 1961. And this, the statement and objects and reasons of the bill of the Advocates Act provided that it shall establish All India Bar Council and a common role of advocates. It will integrate, it provided for integration of bar into single class of legal practitioners known as advocates. So earlier, what was known as leaders, muktas, wakils, etc., were thereafter to be renamed as advocates. And it provided for prescription of a uniform qualification for admission of persons as advocates. The division of advocates into senior and other advocates based on merit is provided under Section 16 of the Advocates Act of 1961. Then creation of autonomous bar councils, one for the whole of India and the other for each state. And the Advocates Act 1961 amends and consolidates the law relating to legal practitioners. And the Act, in its pith and substance, is an enactment dealing with qualifications, enrollment, right to practice, and discipline of advocates. So these are the basic objects and reasons for which the Advocates Act was enacted by the All India Bar Committee. So briefly, we'll go through some of the sections of the Act, and then we'll go to the professional conduct and etiquettes of the legal profession. The Advocates Act 1961, Section 3 provides for the constitution of Bar Council for each state. So therefore, this is how it is a statutory body created by way of an Advocates Act passed by the Parliament, which establishes the Bar Council for each state. And Section 4 provides for the constitution of Bar Council of India. So it is under Section 3 and 4 that a statutory authority, and namely the Bar Council of India as well as the Bar Council for each state, came to be established by way of the Advocates Act of 1961. Now the functions of the state Bar Councils are provided under Section 6, and the functions of the Bar Council of India are provided under Section 7, which we'll go through. Our Section 6 provides for the functions, which are to admit persons as advocates on its roll. So there is a role maintained by each state bar council where the advocates are enrolled. And they are issued the certificate, which is also known as sanad. And once you clear your law and then apply for an enrollment certificate. You get a certificate of practice. And I think now, in our time, we did not have the All India Bar Examination, but now with the AIB, once you clear that, you get the, initially, I think you get the provisional certificate and thereafter you get the certificate of practice. So these are all part of the roles of the State Bar Council. Then they prepare and maintain such roles. Then the important function of the Bar Council is also to determine cases of misconduct against advocates on its role. So this is also a very important area where the Bar Council supervises the conduct of the advocates. And on an application or a complaint received by the State Bar Council, a disciplinary committee, which is formed under the Bar Council, would look into the matter. If the Bar Council finds that there is a case made out against the advocate for misconduct. So therefore, it supervises the conduct of the advocates. It promotes and supports law reforms. It also, its function is to conduct seminars on legal topics. And also, importantly, they have to carry on the continuous legal education, though it is not mandatory in India. But it is required, and a lot of seminars have been organized by Bar Councils. It organizes legal aid for the poor. And very important other function is to visit and inspect universities. And as Yukti mentioned, that the role of Bar Council is also very important on the legal for the universities, because it grants them approvals. It continuously visits and inspects them. And there are rules which have been framed on legal education by the Bar Council of India. And therefore, these are the brief and basic functions of the State Bar Councils. And similarly, the functions of the Bar Council of India are provided under Section 7 of the Advocates Act. And it provides to lay down standards of professional conduct and etiquette for advocates. And this we are going to discuss today, the professional conduct and etiquettes, and they are very important, which every lawyer must, every advocate must remember in practice. Second is to safeguard the rights, privileges, and interests of advocates. Third is to promote and support law reforms. Then to promote legal education and to lay down standards of such education in consultation with the universities in India. So this is what Yukti mentioned. And there have been regulations which have been enacted by the Bar Council of India. It determines universities whose degree in law shall be qualification for enrollment as an advocate. It conducts seminars on legal topics by eminent jurists and published journals and papers of legal interest, and organize and provide legal aid to the poor. So these are the brief functions of the Bar Council of India, provided under Section 7 of the Advocates Act of 1961. One very important function, as I mentioned, is to provide legal aid to the poor. And it is a very important role of a lawyer in the society to provide legal aid to every person who comes for his assistance. And also the professional conduct rules say that a lawyer cannot refuse a brief, and we will discuss that when we go through that. But it is a very important role of a lawyer and advocate to provide legal aid to the poor. So that is the function of Bar Council of India as well as the State Bar Councils, to organize and provide legal aid to the poor. Also, there are committees which providing legal services to the poor and needy persons. And they also have a panel of advocate which provides legal assistance. But this is a very, very important part and a duty of a lawyer to provide legal aid to the poor and to the needy who have a good case. And if any of you who want to enter into litigation, every high court has a legal service committee. And if you can enroll in that committee and provide legal service, that will give you a very good experience of conducting matters before the high court. It will also give you a very good exposure before the courts. And I also am a part of legal service committee in the High Court of Gujarat, and I've been providing legal service since almost 5 to 6 years. But I got to argue a lot of criminal appeals, and a lot of appeals where the sentences were of life imprisonment imposed against the accused. And those matters go before the division bench. And the preparation it requires is immense, and the exposure that it gives you is also immense. And I have seen in my earlier young days when I was arguing these appeals, the courts also are quite helpful. And they also, when going through the entire paperwork, try to give points and help if lawyers are appearing on the legal service committee. So therefore, it gives a very, very good exposure, and that would be my advice to those of you interested in joining litigation. Of course, a very good senior's office and a very good mentor is certainly required. But also, this exposure would give you a lot of learning. And if you can join enroll yourself as a panel advocate with the Legal Service Authority, I think that will be a great start to your career in litigation. Because courts also recognize and appreciate your efforts in which you give in legal service to the poor and needy person. So therefore, this is an important role for both the Bar Council of India as well as the state bar councils to organize and provide legal aid to the poor. Then is to recognize foreign qualifications in law obtained outside India for admission as an advocate. And the 9th is to manage and invest funds of the Bar Council. And 10 is to provide for the election of its member who shall run the Bar Council. So these are all provisions which are prescribed under the Advocates Act with regards to the election of its member to manage and invest funds of the Bar Council. In the times of COVID, the Bar Councils did gather a lot of funds and help the young lawyers who could not sustain themselves due to the closure of courts. So Bar Council, the state as well as the central Bar Council, does come out with a lot of schemes for the benefit of young members and needy members of the profession. So I hope till now you have been clear with what is the functions of the Bar Council of State as well as the Bar Council of India. Now we would be going towards the standard of professional conduct and etiquettes for advocates. And there are regulations which have been framed by the Bar Council of India. But before that, I'd like to start with you on the role of advocates and how important words are with regards to the legal profession. By a short story which was told to be by one of a very senior advocate in High Court. And he used to say that a lawyer and an engineer were together outside a church, and they were just speaking with themselves, saying that, can you convince the father, the priest of the church, to allow you to smoke when you are inside the church? The engineer said, yes, I can certainly convince the priest, and if I say, he will not refuse. And the lawyer also said, okay, we'll try, let's see who can convince the priest. So first the engineer goes to the priest and says, father, can I smoke while praying? So father says, no, you can't do that. You can't pray and while smoking. And he says, you are not allowed here, you go out. And then the lawyer goes to the father and says that, father, can I pray while smoking? And kindly see the words. The engineer says, can I smoke while praying? And he refuses. But here the lawyer, the advocate, says, can I pray while smoking? So the father says, yes, you can do whatever you want to do and you can pray. So this is how the importance of words are in our legal profession. And therefore, use of words is one of the most important aspects of our profession. And the clarity of thought and the clarity of expression are one of the most two important skills that you can develop during your study as well as after your study into the real professional world when you enter. So these two skills are very important, the clarity of thought and clarity of expression, which will help you in developing your career in this profession. So yes, so now let's briefly deal with the standard of professional conduct and etiquettes for advocates. So the main object of the professional ethics of advocacy is to maintain the dignity of the legal profession. The Chief Justice Marshall had observed that the fundamental aim of legal ethics is to maintain the honor and dignity of the law profession, to secure a spirit of friendly cooperation between the bench and bar in the promotion of higher standard of justice, to establish honorable and fair dealings of the counsel with his client, opponent and witness, and to establish a spirit of brotherhood with bar itself, and to secure that lawyers discharge their responsibilities to the community generally. So he beautifully sums up the entire aspect, object and aim of legal ethics and why they are so important is to honor and maintain the dignity of law profession and to secure a spirit of friendly cooperation between the bench and the bar. Because the bar has a very important role to play with regards to the dispensation of justice and the administration of the entire justice delivery system. And they are officers of the court, and they assist the court in coming to a just and fair conclusion with regards to the dispute between the parties. So their first role is towards the court, because they are the officers of the court. They are not just simply the agents of their clients. Client is not a principal, and the advocates are not simply agents. They are first the officers of the court, and then comes their interest towards their client. So therefore, the lawyer has to balance all these responsibilities that he has, of first being an officer of the court, the second being to secure the interest of his client. He also owes a duty towards the opponent. He owes a duty towards the society, to the court. And he also owes a duty to his brother advocates. So therefore, there has to be a fine balance which he has to maintain by observing and the professional ethics of advocacy, which are prescribed by the Bar Council of India. So the legal profession is not a business, of course. You are aware, it's a profession, and it is one of the noble professions. And therefore, it should not be treated as a business. It has been created by the state for the public good. And therefore, consequently, the essence of the profession lies in three things, which are the organization of its members for the performance of their function, maintenance of certain standards, intellectual and ethical, for the dignity of the profession, and the subordination of pecuniary gains to efficient service. So these three form the pillars of professional ethics. Your pecuniary gains as a lawyer should be subordinate to the services that you are rendering, and your efficiency should be of a top-notch quality. Otherwise, you are not in this profession only to make money, and that is the whole concept and idea of professional ethics.
Sir, I'm really sorry to interrupt. In case you are assessing the slides, we cannot actually see them moving.
Okay.
So we are on the fourth slide.
I see. Okay. So how come that? What slide are you? What is it showing?
It's showing the Bengal Regulation 7 of 1793, the fourth slide.
I see. Okay. All right. No, good that you inform me, otherwise I would.
Yes, and now we can see it moving. So.
Okay. All right. So I was here, but I will share. You can share the slides with the students so that.
Yes, sir, definitely. The PowerPoint presentation, yes.
That is confused, sir. Right. Okay. So, yes, we were on the rules of the only professional standards that an advocate needs to maintain, which are mentioned in Chapter 2, Part 4 of the Bar Council of India rules. These rules have been placed under Section 49(1)(c) of the Advocates Act. And as I mentioned, the advocate's duty towards the court are that he has to act in a dignified manner all the time when he is arguing, when he is in the court. He has to respect the court. He cannot communicate in private, in the sense that he cannot communicate without the consent of his client to the other side or to the other side's advocate with respect to his matter. Then the fourth is to refuse to act in an illegal manner towards the opposition. So if his client says that you act in a manner which is not authorized against the opposition, then he has to refuse to act in an illegal manner towards the opposition. So he has to be fair to the opposite side, to the opponent as well. He cannot act in an illegal manner towards the opposition. Refuse to represent clients who insist on unfair means. So a lot of times client insist on using unfair means by producing false evidence or by stating something which is not correct. Then the lawyer's duty towards the court is to refuse to represent clients who insist on unfair means. And also appear in proper dress code. So these are the brief duties that a lawyer or an advocate has towards the court. And they are to act in dignified manner. He cannot act in a manner which is not dignified or which lowers down the respect of the court. He cannot use such words which are unparliamentary. And therefore, he always has to act in a dignified manner when he is in the courtroom or also outside the court. Because a lawyer is not seen as a common person, because he is respected due to his profession. And he has to maintain this respect throughout, either in court or outside the court. He always has to act in a dignified manner. And therefore, he has to ensure that he respects the court inside as well as outside. So that is, these are the duties which are prescribed under the regulations with regards to the advocate's duty towards the court. The next is the advocate's duties towards the client. Now, here is a very interesting regulation which says that he is bound to accept briefs. And a lot of times in law schools, whenever I go, I come across this question. That, especially under criminal, a lawyer who is practicing on criminal side, students do ask that why should a lawyer accept a brief if he believes his client to have actually committed an offence. But here, the regulation provides that the advocate is bound to accept briefs. So therefore, if on his opinion, if an advocate feels that his client has committed the offence and therefore he feels he does not want to represent him, then such a stance is against the professional conduct set up by the Bar Council of India under the Advocates Act. And therefore he is in breach of his duty if he refuses a brief on the ground that he believes his client to be involved in an offense of a serious nature. So a lot of students ask that if he has committed rape, or if he is a terrorist, or if he has committed murder, why should any lawyer represent a person like him if he confesses before the advocate saying that yes, I have committed, or if the lawyer comes to know during the trial. But here what I believe is that, one, you can't refuse, and that is what is provided under the regulation, a brief because of your opinion. Second is that you are not a judge, of the case. You are there to represent him in a trial, which will be conducted by the court by providing all the defenses that you have, you can present before the court in a just and legal manner, without violating any of the law, without using any false evidence, or without fabricating any evidence, or without misleading the court. And the third reason, or the third area, which sometimes questions are asked, that if the client confesses before the advocate that he has committed the offense, and then the advocate feels, or his moral conscience tells him not to appear, then can he refuse the plea? To that, there is some material and the opinions of very senior lawyers who say that if you have already accepted the plea and you are defending him in trial and during the trial proceedings, if he confesses to you, then you should not refuse the brief on his confession, how much, whatever the offense may be. But if you have not accepted the brief, and if he confesses, and if you do not want to take up his case, then without justifiable reason, you must not refuse. But still, if your moral conscience does not allow you to accept that brief on his confession, then you can refuse him. So this is what I believe. Though I appear in criminal matters and criminal appeals, not trials, so, where sometimes clients or the convicts do repent and say that yes, I have committed an offense and I made a big mistake. But I have to represent them in court, so therefore I do take up cases and I don't refuse it on the ground that they have confessed, because my role is limited just to present the law and the facts before the court, and then the court has to decide. Also, there is a very important constitutional right which an accused or a convict has, is not to be convicted for an offense which is more serious in nature when that offense has not been committed. So therefore, if there are arguments which could be made within the four corners of law, then a lawyer should not refuse a brief only because he thinks that his client has committed an offense. So therefore, advocate's duty towards the client provides that he is bound to accept the briefs. Now there can be circumstances which may justify his refusal to accept a particular brief, and that are briefly I mentioned some of them. That if the lawyer or the advocate is physically disabled to appear, so he can of course refuse. If he is not available to present the case, then again he can refuse briefs. Third, there is training in a special branch limits his usefulness in other branches. So of course, if he's practicing on, say, corporate side or company side or before the NCLT, DRT, and if he's asked to appear in a trial court, then he can certainly refuse by saying that his usefulness is limited in other branches of law. And to engage a lawyer who specifically deals with criminal or whatever, civil trial or whatever trial it may be. The next reason when an advocate can refuse is where the client is not prepared and able to pay him his reasonable fees. So on this ground, but the court provides is a reasonable fees. It's not that any fees that you can charge and the client is not able to pay, then he can refuse. Where the client is not prepared and able to pay him his reasonable fees, then he can certainly refuse to accept that plea. Next is that when he is likely to be called as witness in the same case. Now this is also a very important the reason why he should not accept a brief. If the police has recorded his statement or if he is a witness of some crime, then he must not engage himself as an advocate in the same case. So this is a very important provision, regulation with regards to professional ethics and professional etiquette. The next is when he has already been consulted by the other side. So there's a conflict of interest, if the other side has also consulted with her, then he cannot appear for the opponent. And that would be conflict of interest. And so what happens is a lot of big companies, what they do is, if they have a, and big companies do have a lot of cases going on. So what they do is they engage senior lawyers just for opinions or on retainership. And what happens is then they having already been on their retainership, they cannot be engaged and they cannot accept briefs for the other side. So this rule has been used and also misused by some of the big corporates. But yes, the rule is clear. The advocate who has been consulted by the other side cannot appear for the opponent. So therefore, if there is a conflict of interest, then lawyer, the advocate's duty towards the client is not to accept the plea. Second is that not withdraw from service. So once having accepted the brief, he cannot withdraw from service unless the client wants to engage another advocate. So therefore, he himself cannot withdraw from the engagement that he has already entered with the client. The third is not appear in matters where he himself is a witness, which we already saw that he can refuse. But the regulation provides that not to appear in matters. So if in a case where he himself is a witness, he can refuse the brief, and also he must not appear in matters where he himself is a witness. And to just give you an example, there was a murder outside the High Court of Gujarat. I don't know whether you know or not. A very famous RTI activist who had filed a lot of cases against the mining mafias, and he was shot just opposite the High Court, and he had just met his lawyers and was going to his residence, where he was shot outside the High Court. So his lawyers were also witness in that investigation that was being carried out, and therefore still they were appearing in his matter, and therefore the High Court said that you can't appear because of this regulation under the professional conduct and etiquettes for advocates, and therefore they had to withdraw their appearance from that matter and could not appear for the victim and his family. So these are the advocate's duties towards the client. Next is to uphold the interest of the client. Now this provides that it shall be the duty of an advocate to fearlessly uphold the interest of his client by all fair and honorable means. An advocate shall do so without regard to any unpleasant consequences to himself or any other. He shall defend a person accused of a crime regardless of his personal opinion as to the guilt of the accused. An advocate should always remember that his loyalty is to the law, which requires that no man should be punished without adequate evidence, and not suppress material or evidence, and not charge depending on success of matters. So these are also important professional ethics which a lawyer has to follow. He has to uphold the interest of his client in a fearless manner, but he has to ensure that without any unpleasant consequences to himself or to any other. So in court, being fearless does not mean to criticize the judge. He can put across his point fearlessly, whatever he believes is the correct proposition of law, but not in an unpleasant manner or in a manner which harms the dignity or disrespects the court. So therefore, he has to maintain a fine balance of all the duties that he owes to the court, to his client, to the opponent, etc. So he cannot conducting a matter, suppress material or evidence from the court. He cannot produce false evidence, and he can also not suppress material evidence from the court, because that would amount to suppression of material evidence, and that would be harmful to his client. So therefore, that is what is prescribed under the professional conduct rules, not to suppress material or evidence, and not charge pending on success of matters. This is also important. This is concept of champerty, which is not acceptable in India, and it is against the professional conduct of advocates. You can't charge your client depending on the success of him. You can't say you pay me so much amount if you win the matter. You have to charge your fees and run the brief. But you can't charge depending on the success of the man. That is what is not permitted under the professional conduct rules. So next is the advocate's duty to opponents. So here the advocate's duty to opponents provide not to negotiate directly with opposing party. So without the consent of the client, negotiating directly with the opposite party is in violation of the professional conduct rules, and he must do it only with the consent of his client, not directly. He cannot negotiate directly with opposing party, and he has to carry out the legitimate promise made even to the opponent. So therefore, these are the two duties that an advocate has towards the opponent: not to negotiate directly with the opposing party without the consent of his client, and he has to carry out the legitimate promises made. So if a promise or a compromise has been reached between the two clients, if some of the documents which are to be handed over to the other side and for which the consent has been given under the compromise deed entered between the parties, and if those documents are with the advocate, then the advocate has to, if he has to hand over those documents to the other side, then he cannot, after entering into a agreement, refuse to provide those documents. So that will be a violation of his duty towards the opponents. So he has to carry out legitimate promises made. So these are the two duties that he owes towards the opponents. The next is the advocate's duty towards I'm sorry, that's my daughter.
No problem, sir.
So my office and my residence are together, and this is the sometimes small kids, they enter. Even sometimes in courts also it happens, but courts are also, they also understand that you are working from home, so these all things would happen. Okay, so advocate's duty towards the fellow advocate. Yes, so these are the duties which are prescribed under the code of conduct: not to advertise or solicit work. And this is because of these regulations that lawyers in India cannot advertise or solicit work under the professional conduct rules. Even their signboards and nameplates have to be of reasonable size. They cannot promote unauthorized practice of law. An advocate shall not accept a fee less than the fee which can be taxed under rules when the client is able to pay more. And the consent of fellow advocate to appear has to be taken before appearing in a matter where the other advocate has already been engaged by the client. So these are some of the duties that the advocate owes towards the fellow advocate as well. And ultimately, the advocate also owes a duty towards the society, because he is carrying on the work of dispensation of justice, and he is a very important part towards the administration of justice. So ultimately, he owes a duty towards the society as well, and which he has to take up causes, and he argues for matters for which ramifications are beyond only to his client. Because ultimately, whatever the court is going to hold is going to become the law, and therefore he has to assist the court with the best of his abilities and capability, and also ensure that he raises important causes and brings to the attention of the court important causes. And as we have seen during the COVID times, lot of lawyers filed PIs and appeared parties in person to assess the court when almost every other high court was dealing with COVID pandemic PIs. And they raised a lot of important points. They convinced the court for issuing guidelines and directions, which helped a lot of people in these difficult times of COVID. And therefore, they owe a very important duty towards the society as well. So I think we are left with a couple of minutes. If there are any questions, if anybody want to ask, we can take a question. So we can take questions if anybody wants to ask any questions to the different profession, how to conduct or whatever.
Yes, sir, sure, sir. So we are honored to have you, sir. I would take the opportunity to ask some questions. There are some questions by the students. Some of them are. Sir, how can one being the first generation lawyer with no legal background get himself into litigation with enough confidence that he'll get success in the field where already the client class usually prefers the advocates with a strong legal background and with a strong legal background and good litigation history? I mean, what mindset one should have? This is a question from a student.
Right. Yes, so this is a question a lot of students have. I believe today the opportunities are many. First of all, you have already joined the legal profession and you are going to pass out. So you are going to enter either litigation or non-litigation work. But in order to succeed in litigation, a couple of things which are important is first to develop a mindset towards litigation before entering an office. So first, please understand what are the skills that are required in this profession. And as I mentioned, your clarity of thought and your clarity of expression, which are one of the most essential skills. Try to develop these skills during your college years. Also inculcate the habit of reading and reading a lot of things, not just law, but literature, history, economics, etc. Because your overall development during these 5 years, how you shape yourself, what personality you develop, will take you a long way in litigation, especially in your life, but also particularly in litigation. Then, if you are a first generation lawyer, of course, you would want opportunities to grow. So first thing is develop yourself, inculcate these skills. Also, one of the most important skills that you must have is patience. Because being a first generation lawyer, you will at least need 3 to 5 years to have some mark in the profession and to start gaining the confidence of your colleagues and your seniors so that they can give you work. So patience is very important in the initial years, and a lot of students give up because they feel first impatient and then frustrated in litigation. If you have to enter with a certain mindset that you have to give 5 to 7 years of your initial years and you have to work really hard in those years to at least gain the trust of your senior. Then having a good office will go a long way if you can find a good senior, a good mentor. And by good senior, I wouldn't say only senior counsels or the topmost lawyers in the country or your high court. They are going to be very busy. So what you can do is either join a young, upcoming, budding lawyer whose standing is around 15 to 17 years and who has already established himself. If you can join his office, he would also be looking for colleagues because of his growing practice. And if you can help him and win his trust, then certainly you would get work from him. And otherwise, you can join the legal service committee, as I already mentioned. There you get a lot of matters, though they will be pro bono. You will not get money, though they pay some meager amount, which you'll be able to get. But the experience and exposure that you will get would be far beyond what you would have expected in any other office. And the courts will also encourage you, and you will be able to strike a code and built an image in court. And therefore, that image building is very important in the initial years, which you must keep in mind. And gradually, with every matter, you will learn and you will grow and ultimately have some standing in the profession. But a lot of lawyers who are top lawyers were first generation lawyers, and what they had to go through, I am sure you will not have to go through the same, because now there is a lot of work. The profession has become so diverse. There are so many tribunals, there are so many adjudicating authorities, that you will certainly find work and you will certainly find a good office. And if you stick and if you give your best, you will certainly grow in this profession.
Thank you, sir. So the second question is, as we are aware that role of Bar Council is not just limited to professional ethics and conducts of lawyers, but has a greater impact upon the legal education in India. How far do you think BCI, which started as a representation of the bar, can also regulate the legal education in the country well?
Okay. So yes, you are right. They have a very important role to play in legal education. And in 2008, they have come out with these regulations on legal education. And they are providing approvals to universities. They inspect, they visit. They also have a role to play in formulating the course structure. They also prescribe how much hours of lectures are required per week or per month. So they have a lot of supervision with regards to legal education in universities as well. So yes, they are playing a very important role in legal education. And with I don't know whether you are aware, but also the first five-year national law school, that is national law school in India, which started in Bangalore, was also the brainchild Mr. Menon, and he was supported by the Bar Council of India at that time. And therefore, Bar Council of India and thereafter has started these national law schools in every state. Probably now we have around 15 to 17 national law schools. So therefore, they are playing an important role in the legal education. And certainly, even what I feel is not just in universities, they must also have these continuous legal training programs for lawyers as well. Because not every lawyer gets an opportunity to pass out from these premier law schools. And therefore, while during practice also, they do conduct these workshops and seminars. But there has to be some continuous legal training programs which are there in other countries like UK and US. They must incorporate that in legal profession as well. I hope that answers your question.
Thank you, sir. It was a very enlightening session. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you very much for having me. I hope
sir, adding to that, thank you, sir, personally from me to agreeing to come up and take time from your busy schedule. I'm sure that right now you still have the court to attend.
Yes.
So I'm really sorry about that. And thank you so much, sir, that you took out time and you take out, took up this important session for us, and I'm sure that the students had a lot to learn.
Thank you so much for inviting me. Also, you can go through my YouTube channel. There are a lot of videos that are posted, landmarks in the law, a lot of interesting topics on constitutional law and criminal law. If students are interested, you can share the link. I'll share it with you, Prashant.
Definitely, sir.
Right. All right. Thank you very much, Prashant.
Thank you so much, sir.
And I hope to see you again. If you have any other interesting topic, you can let me know. Thank you.
Yes, sir, definitely.
Thank you. All right, see you. Bye.